my very best friends dropped in for a chat, and he didn't know I was doing a program, so he's on the program. And it's Elliot Prescott, who, when practices properly, is one of the very finest pianists I know. And he was here to show me his extraordinary dissertation on Franz Schubert. He said, "Are we playing Schubert?" And I said, "Chopin." He said, "I like him also." Elliot, how are you?
Very well, David. It's more than a pleasure to be here with you.
Thank you. If you heard the program last night, we had said that we are going to play the mighty, I think you'd agree with me, the mighty fantasy in F minor of Chopin, one of his great works, huh?
Absolutely agree.
And yet you have told me that you found it also very strange.
For a long time, I did find a mystery there.
Yeah.
But I've come to enjoy it more and more.
That insane march in the work used to disturb you.
Yes.
It's an unusual work. It was composed at Nohant, the country estate of George Sand, in 1841. And at that time, Chopin was, I think, at the height of his famous relationship with that notorious woman. And probably one of the great pianists of the world is up for our first performance. Would you like to hear Arthur Rubinstein?
Very much.
Good. Let's begin then with the F minor fantasy, Opus 49, Arthur Rubinstein, pianist.
Thank you.
Arthur Rubinstein in the Fantasy in F Minor. My guest is Elliot Prescott, a good friend of mine. Did you enjoy the performance?
I did, David. Very, very fine in many ways. And I felt at the end, maybe a small point in relation to something as great as Chopin piano works, but his codas always seem to be so right for the piece. They always seem to conclude.
Yes, Chopin's codas seem to come out of the work, and yet they are all new material usually. Witness the ballades. Think of those codas or the scherzi. And yet also, some of his works, especially the dance forms, the early dance forms, the Polonaise in C-sharp minor, no ending at all, no coda. The military Polonaise, what a work that really would be if it had a big coda. Mm. Just ends. But as he grew, he would make very elaborate codas. And this Fantasy in F minor is certainly a sane piece of art, unlike Schumann's Fantasy.
Yes, you almost get the feeling that it's not a fantasy.
Because it's so strict, really. It's so classical. And it's in a huge ABA form, really. It's simple in its structure, and yet it's a complicated piece of music. But Chopin is a romantic composer, of course, but I really believe this is the reason that he transcends the tastes of individual generations, because there is this great classical underpinning, the Schumann Fantasy. Isn't that a strange conglomeration of a thousand moods? Well, Chopin always pinpoints what he wants to do formally, and I think the secret of all great music is this classical underpinning.
Yes, I agree, and that I think we're going to have another performance of the Fantasy, mm-hmm. aren't we? I want to hear that glorious middle section again in B major. That theme always does something to me.
Yes. Let's hear it in a performance by Jeanne-Marie Darré.
Thank you.
the Chopin Fantasy in F minor. Niecks wrote, Chopin's genius had now reached the most perfect stage of its development and was radiating with all the intensity of which its nature was capable. This is Opus 49. And that was Jeanne-Marie Darré. Strange is a marvelous performance in many ways, Elliot, and I wonder why she made the last marvelous arpeggiation, which is so warm-blooded. She played it with so little pedal. It was dry. I think that was a major mistake.
Yeah, I felt that way too. Also, interestingly, Oscar informs me that the Darré performance is only 50 seconds more than Rubinstein, yet somehow the Rubinstein seemed quicker to me, somehow more compact. This seemed to drag on in areas.
Rubinstein has that wonderful inner time cycle that can make a half hour work, or the Schubert B flat, a work that you've often played, sound like no time at all. I think it's a wonderful inner thing. It just works or it doesn't, and he has it. There's no doubt about it. He gives you the grand lines of a composition.
Yes, and also getting your works.
I think so.
Rather than in the earlier works, that are, the sections are very well defined.
Oh yes, so his phraseology as he grows becomes more and more subtle, but. Why the term fantasy this is interesting. We were talking before about how very, very classical and tightly structured this is, and yet fantasy.
Yeah. Yes, I was looking at the work the other day, and it's a very clear-cut harmonic scheme, you know, of A section.
What is it? Yeah.
Well, it's basically an ABA, and the A section begins with that wonderful opening in F minor, and then it goes into there are episodes of I believe in the key of A flat, C minor, E flat, and G flat. Then the section closes with the first two episodes again in C and in G flat. Then that marvelous haunting B major section, which is the central section of the work, and then the other four episodes come back. Respective keys a fourth away to the first time they appeared, D flat, F minor, A flat, and C minor, and then finally ending in the relative major, in A flat major.
It's always amazed me that you can look at a score, and I've seen it many times in my life, and within no time analyze it. It's a wonderful gift. You know, we have now one of the most beautiful of his miniatures, the Berceuse.
I love that.
It's really
forward hearing.
It's really an amazing piece. It's Opus 57, and we have a performance by Alicia de Larrocha. Chopin's Berceuse, Opus 57, D-flat major. What a miracle of pyrotechnical coloratura, isn't it, Elliot?
Absolutely. Just so beautifully ornamental and yet so simple, too.
And, of course, the harmonies are really the same throughout the whole piece in the left hand, right?
Yes, that's right.
It's the unbelievable set of variations, really, on this perfect lullaby tune. And what did you think of the De La Rocha performance?
I'd like to hear another performance. There was some, I thought, some lovely sounds. I found it a bit, I must admit, a bit ploddy.
Yes, her sound is nice. I think she started wrong instantly in the inflection of her main theme, and the tempo must move. What was the time? Well, we have Rubinstein coming up, and we were discussing before how Rubinstein makes something move. What was Alicia de Larrocha's time?
440.
What's Rubinstein's?
433.
Very close. Let's hear how we feel about the movement, the inner movement. Here's Rubinstein in the Berceuse. Thank you. Elliot?
That was better. That suited me better.
Yeah. Chopin's Cradle Song, and James Huneker says, well, it's certainly has to be a lullaby, a cradle song for a very aristocratic child. But he had a certain snobbish thing going. Rubinstein moved it along, and yet it was just a few seconds less than the much longer performance of De La Rocha. How would you like to hear...
I would like to hear another performance of
it. Yes, how would you like to hear Josef Hofmann?
I would like to hear that. I hear that Stanley Waldoff was on, the young American pianist, that was his favorite pianist.
Well, he goes wild over Hofmann, as everyone knows. But this is in... Oscar, it was 4:33, the Rubinstein. This is 3 minutes and 2 seconds.
Wow.
I'd like to hear how you think of this performance. Let's hear the Chopin Berceuse and the pianist Josef Hofmann. Over a minute difference in the Hofmann performance. What does that smile mean? It's very enigmatic. Did you like it? Did you hate it?
No, I liked it, and it brings to mind the thought that Hofmann's performance is always something different than anything.
Yes, it's always
any
different.
Of the other brands.
Yeah, it's he just takes flight, and of course the pearly technique in the right hand is just unbelievable. I want to read to you, Elliot, this this prose by Honecker because he got very inspired over this piece. The romantic writers on music, I envy them because they could absolutely write as they feel. Today I think we fear that a bit. He writes modulations from pigeon egg blue to pale green, most misty and subtle modulations that dissolve before one's eyes, and for a moment the sky is peppered with tiny stars in doubles, each independently treated. Within a small segment of the chromatic bow, Chopin has imprisoned new, strangely dissonant colors. It is a miracle, and after the drawn-out chord of the dominant seventh and the rain of silvery fire ceases, one realizes that the whole piece is a delicious illusion, nothing but an undulation in the key of D-flat, the apotheosis of pyrotechnical coloratura.
I tell you, David, he really took the words right out of my mouth.
Oh, thank you very much. Let's hear the great English pianist Solomon in the Berceuse.
Thank you.
And that was Solomon in the cradle song, the lullaby of Chopin.
Beautiful, just beautiful. You know, it was slow, and yet it moved. He just spun out those lines. It kept moving, and it kept carrying you along. It was very, very beautiful.
Here's a four-page work, right, that Solomon played in 3 seconds under 5 minutes, and Hofmann did it in 3 minutes. Both were very convincing performances.
That's what's wonderful about the piano, playing the piano.
Music itself.
The music itself,
yeah.
Yes.
My guest, Elliot Prescott. And Elliot, thank you for listening with me. And I should say that you are, besides a wonderful pianist, the chairman of the piano faculty at the Harlem School of the Arts. And I know that there's a Chopin program coming up there. Your students or the all of the students in the school. Is that it?
That's right. About 3 or 4 months ago, I was listening to your program, and I got inspired, and I chose then to have an all-Chopin program, and I'd like to take, it's going to be on April the 10th at 10 o'clock in the morning, that's a Saturday. I'd like to take this opportunity to invite you to come there and hear the kids play, you know. They're really marvelous. And
all the children are doing a different Chopin
they're
work?
They're all doing a different Chopin work, including ballade, impromptus, preludes, nocturnes, waltzes.
Wonderful. You're inviting me, and are you inviting the audience?
Absolutely.
The Harlem School of the Arts, then, in an all Chopin program by the children, and when?
That's April 10th, Saturday, 10 o'clock in the morning.
Open and to the public, right?
Yeah, it's open to the
wonderful.
Public.
Wonderful. Then I'll be there, Elliot.
Where?
The Harlem School, where is it?
That's located at 141st Street and St. Nicholas Avenue in
great.
The St. James Church.
Elliot, thank you for coming.
It was one of my great pleasures and a great deal of fun I might have had.
It's good listening. Thank you for listening.